Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Love and Truth Principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes God's principles of love and truth that govern the operation of God's laws, gives examples of the way these principles are built into God's laws, and answers audience questions about the principles. Recorded on the 5th of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Okay, thanks guys for coming back on time. Love and truth principles is the subject of this discussion. And obviously we want to discuss each one at a time. And we've only got 20 minutes for each one to discuss, and then we've only got 15 minutes for each one with Q&A. So it's going to be quite a tight presentation. I'll have to make sure I just keep an eye on my times, and which means I need to turn my pages that have my times on them, just so that I do that. Okay. All right. So here we go. Love principles first. So we'll just look at love principles first. Let's have a bit of a summary of love principles so that we can see what we're talking about. So love principles envelop God's love around each creation principle and law, like an envelope, inside of which all the principles and laws and creations exist. So it ensures that love governs all principles. So you could say love and truth are the highest of the hierarchy of God's principles. So just like God's laws have hierarchy, where some are more powerful, have more ability to control others than other laws do, so too do God's principles. And love and truth principles are actually the highest of all principles. Now, we'll talk about why that is, and I notice some of you have asked questions about why that is, and we'll talk a bit about why that is a bit later. Also, love is enforced, compelled, and upheld. Now, when we say love is enforced, did most of you find yourself having a bit of an emotional reaction to that? How can it be love when it was enforced? Is that kind of the reaction you were having? And we don't mean that love is forced upon things, but rather that love inside the universe itself is enforced as a part of the way the universe is governed by enforcing it upon each law. So every law has love built into it. And every law wants to compel love, but also it does enforce love. Every law enforces love. This is how God stops us from being anarchists, by actually enforcing God's principles upon all of God's creations. Does that make sense? So the way God forces things is a bit different the way you would force something. You know, you usually do it with some yelling and screaming, right? And if that doesn't work, then maybe some punching and other things might work. And if that doesn't work, then maybe a gun. And if that doesn't work, a bazooka. And if that doesn't work, then a nuclear weapon will probably do it for you. That's not how God works, of course. Right? All creation experiences God's love in different degrees. And obviously, each of the creations, there are some creations, well, one creation that's self-aware, the human soul, and that creation is obviously going to experience God's love differently to anything that is unaware, not self-aware. But still, each creation experiences God's love in some way. All creation demonstrates and facilitates the flow of God's principled love. Now, principled love here is that term. There's a Greek expression called agape love, which is a love based upon principle, and the principle being truth, ethics, morality from God's perspective. And so all creation demonstrates it. If you examine a creation in a vacuum, if you could do such a thing, you would find that particular creation demonstrates love and truth in some way, right? Now, the problem for humanity, of course, is that no creations that exist around us are in a vacuum because we, our soul, has been placed as the pinnacle or the high, in the hierarchical point of the most powerful of God's creation. So our soul dictates the responses of other creations. So we've got to be very careful sometimes in measuring how creations respond, because we've got to also factor in the fact that our soul condition is affecting how that creation is responding. And therefore we need to take consideration of that fact when we examine truths inside of other creatures or creations. But all creation demonstrates and facilitates the flow of God's principled love in some way. Every single creation does. Even at its worst, so even the human at their worst has some parts of God's love either functioning in their body or functioning in some form, in their spirit form, that demonstrate God's love. It's very interesting how God's done this. It's a very powerful thing, because it means that even in your very worst condition, you can experience a little bit of love. And even in your very worst condition, you can discover something about love. So, and without this being possible, it would be impossible for you to really know what love is, in fact. So the human soul also has the potential, because of this principle, to actually enter that self-aware love state with God, where you actually have that personal relationship. And these are the principles that govern every single one of God's other principles and every single one of God's other laws. You can almost say that all of God's other principles are contained within the love principle. Right? So it makes sense that if you learn about love, you'll probably learn a lot about the other principles. That makes sense, doesn't it? And in fact, you think about what we've been trying to share with you for many years now. We've been focusing on love and truth, haven't we? All the time with you two, with all of the discussions we've had, primarily on those things. But you have learnt a little bit about economy and a little bit about function, a little bit about these other things, the subsequent hierarchy, governance and so forth, as a result of the discussion about love, because these are all facets of love. So you could almost say these other principles are describing to you what love actually is, right? And they actually are doing that. God's definition of love is described by the principles that God has and imposes upon law. All right, so that's just a brief summary of the love principle. Of course, there's a lot more involved in that, but let's have a look at it in creation, shall we? An example. Let's look at the example of gravity. So, gravity lovingly promotes an environment that results in my being able to fearlessly express myself and enjoy my life. Now, how does it do that? Well, it's quite simple, really. We've got the Earth. Does any of you know how big the Earth is? Kilometres-wise? Circumference?
46,000
Ks? So I think it's 40,075 Ks or something like that. And so it's spinning around. How many hours a day? It's about 24, isn't it? It's actually a touch less than that, but we call it 24. So you divide that by 24, and how much is that? It's 1,670, around about, kilometres per hour. Right? So it's going, like a spinning top, right? But for us, we don't fly off into outer space. But the laws of physics would normally, without gravity, dictate that we fly off in outer space. The problem with flying off in outer space is we can't breathe there. So we die instantly. So how is the law helping provide a loving environment? It's keeping a gravitational field that pulls all the atmosphere in, keeps me on the planet. So I go around with the Earth. So I have my relative speed is zero compared to the Earth, unless I'm running and then it's 5 or 10 Ks or whatever. And if I'm driving a car, it might be 100 or 200 Ks, depending on how fast I'm going. But I have a relative speed to the Earth. I'm not having to worry about the fact that I'm flying around at 1,670 kilometres an hour. Potentially flying out into outer space at any moment. Now, imagine if you woke up and the very first thing your mum and dad tried to teach you was just be very careful about there's no gravity here. You're going to fly off in outer space if you're not careful. Now, this is what somebody would have to teach you if you were born on a spaceship, right? Isn't it? There's no gravity, very little gravity, unless there's some kind of centrifugal force that creates it. And so that's one of the things I'd have to educate you about, right? Just be very careful about that. You know, you potentially might die in a few moments if that happens to you. But gravity allows this Earth to have this atmosphere, allows the Earth to keep us on the Earth, and therefore creates a safe environment for our learning experience. Isn't that loving? So you see, gravity is actually a loving law. Makes sense, right? Let's look at aerodynamics. Aerodynamics, remember, is just the part of aerodynamics we're looking at here is not the part where sails, you know, what the reason why we can sail, and it's not the reason why we have windmills. I'm looking at the aerodynamics involved in flight here, right? So we're just specifically looking at flight. So what does it give me? It gives me a possible experience which exceeds my gravity-bound state, where I can see a lot more and experience a lot more and travel a lot faster and have all these advantages that I didn't have before, where I don't have to, you know, fight my way through forests. I can go over the forest. I don't have to fight my way through all this terrain. I can go over the terrain and get from one place to another, right? Isn't that loving? It's an advantage by knowing the law. If I don't know the law that involves flight, then of course I can't do that. So it's a loving provision of additional higher law. Right? Love based in it still. It gives. Can you see that God's trying to achieve with us to an emotional feeling of his care and love for you there? The emotional feeling here is one of, I'm safe and secure. The emotional feeling here is, I can engage a law and all of a sudden my world expands in terms of my capacity to experience the world, expands. So God wants to create inside of you feelings where you enjoy your life more. All an expression of God's love, right? Interesting, huh? Isn't that fantastic? Yeah. Another example, law of compensation. Now, most of you have been looking at law of compensation going with suspicion, right? you have been, right? You've been going, oh, that damn law of compensation is going to cause me problems, right? But God's actually created to let you know when love has been upheld, because he gives you a positive compensation if that happens, and to let you know when you've compromised love and there's some corrective attitude there to let you know when that's happened. So it's actually a loving provision. The law itself is a loving provision in both cases. Correction and in terms of reward all get imposed upon us in regard to how the law operates. And the beauty of it is even the way God's done it is that acts upon attitudes, emotions and feelings and thoughts as well as the final things we choose to do in our life and even acts upon our desires. Amazing law. Law of compensation is amazing law. It's a combination of many principles to create that law and a great expression, again, of God's love for us, actually. Right? Yeah. So that's another one that's great. Another one, law of forgiveness. Isn't it great that God's designed a law where there's a compassion given to me if I am repentant for things that I've done that are out of harmony with love, or things that I feel, or things that I thought that were out of harmony with love that I can't take back, actually. They go out there and they affect people and they affect their lives and potentially could have affected, and most of the time would have affected, if it was out of harmony with love, would have affected everyone around me negatively in some way. And all I've got to do is have a sincere feeling, and when I say all I've got to do, as many of you know, it's pretty hard, but all I've got to do is have a sincere feeling of sorrow, repentance about that behaviour, understanding what I've caused, and God will forgive me for those things that I've done, even though I can't undo them. What a loving provision. So you can go around destroying not only your own life and other people's life, but at some point in the future, if you have a sincere feeling of repentance and forgiveness, you can ask for forgiveness and receive it. But of course, it's going to be measured by sincerity. And most people who have chosen to hurt other people don't have much sincerity. So the law doesn't work for them. Right? And this is why, for many of us, it's still not working. Because there's not much sincerity there yet. Does that make sense? Yeah. Robert, you'd like to ask if we just have the mic?
Just with engaging the law of forgiveness, I was wondering if that sincere desire, does that set in place like a chain of events that will eventually correct those things that even I can't?
Yes, it does, Robert, but the reality is only God can correct a lot of those things anyway. But your repentance actually engages, through another law, God's heart to actually take further action to correct those things.
Yep.
Besides the action God's already taken.
Yep.
See, normally God won't correct your actions under normal circumstances. Under normal circumstances, God has said you're a self-responsible being, so anything you create is your responsibility to fix. That's normal circumstances. When you engage this law, God's saying, no, I'll help you fix it. Isn't that loving?
That's pretty cool.
It's pretty cool, isn't it? It's like having a dad who says, right, you make some mistakes, you're on your own, except when you demonstrate true sorrow for what you've done, and then I'll help you fix what you did. That's pretty good, eh?
Yeah.
And it's appropriate you're on your own if you're not repentant, isn't it?
Yeah.
Of course it is.
Okay,
you
thanks.
Are a self-responsible being. So, yeah, it's a lovely provision God's made.
Thank you.
Yeah. So there's our love principles, basically, with some examples. Now, you've noticed that we've skipped over the definition and the objectives and what it reveals about God and all these other things. But I would like to focus on one aspect of what it does reveal about God, and that is that God wants you to enjoy feelings associated with love, like loving feelings. Now, man, it's hard to even find a human parent who wants that. Most human parents want you to do what they want to enjoy their feeling. Right? They don't want you to have your own feelings and to enjoy them. Most human parents have very strong demands on children. But God's completely different to that. God wants you to have your feelings and to enjoy them. It's amazing when you think about it. And then God created a whole heap of laws that let you have feelings. You wouldn't have feelings without God's mathematical laws governing the soul. You just wouldn't have them. There'd be no such thing as a feeling or an emotion. You just wouldn't have them. So you imagine life without emotion. And most of us go, I'd love to have a life without emotion. That's what I'm trying to achieve, right? But if you think about it more seriously, you think, oh, hang on a sec, that would mean I'd be without the emotion of love, I'd be without the emotion of compassion, I'd be without the emotion of joy, happiness. Imagine that, just numb. See, what do we call that nowadays? Depression, yeah, where we shut down to a lot of different types of emotions. And God doesn't want that to occur. God wants us to experience every emotion to the full capacity. And of course, God only wants us to have what we would call happy emotions or positive emotions, but he also knows that as a result of you breaking God's laws, there will be the potential for you to create sad emotions, anger, fear, and other emotions like that. And notice how I said that. You created them. Right? By, or you or somebody who broke the law, created them. But God even allowed for the potential if you decide to do that. It's like parents saying to you, you can do whatever you want, and whatever you want is going to be your results, but I'll help you recover that if you are repentant, sincerely from the heart. So there we go, love principles. Interesting, huh? Yep, govern everything. Very important to understand. And in fact, the entire time I've been talking to you as a group of people and that I've been doing public seminars, basically I've been talking about two principles, love and truth, those two principles. Now, humanity, how does humanity treat this love principle? Well, we have our own definitions of what love is and we act out those definitions. And to be frank with you, the majority of times what we view love is actually quite selfish. It's actually not love, it's selfishness. Yep. And so we need to change that, don't we? So if we examine the principles themselves, they're impossible for humans to apply fully without receiving God's love. And that makes sense, does it not? Because God has the ultimate definition of love. Therefore, if we want to apply these principles fully, we need to have received some of God's love to know them. And it ensures a purposeful existence and happiness for all creation. And unfortunately, they are the principles that the majority of people have been opposing the most. Yeah. The very thing that brings us the most happiness is the thing we oppose the most. Very interesting. Yeah. Okay. Well, that's love principles. Let's go on to truth principles. Okay. What's the summary of the truth principles? Well, truth principles envelop God's truth around each creation, principle and law. So remember, love envelops God's love around each creation, principle and law. Truth, all that does, the only thing different is it envelops truth, facts, around all of God's principles, creations and law. That's what the truth principle is, quite simply. It ensures that truth is inseparably joined with love. And in fact, the two cannot function without each other. And as we'll learn, as I probably need to state, truth, many of you don't realize, is actually an emotional as well as a physical condition. And for many of you, you've not been seeing that, although you can feel the emotion in opposition to truth, can you not? And what's that? Fear, yeah. That insidious emotion that draws you away from being honest and truthful is fear. So if fear is the emotion that opposes truth, then don't you see that truth must also be an emotion? Must be, right? It has to be emotional in its content, so it's inseparably joined with love. Remember we talked about, whoops, back to front. Remember we talked about love being the way God communicates through emotion? And remember I said truth is the mathematical way God communicates through emotion actually too. So mathematics, define your emotions. Interesting concept, but it's true. Truth is enforced and compelled by the law. So God's laws deal in facts. Just facts. That's it. That's why scientists love God's laws so much. Physical laws I'm talking about now. Most scientists have a deep love for physical law because it's all about facts. They can quantify it. They can measure it. They can use it over and over again without having to worry about anything else. It's like factual. And this is the beauty of truth. God's truth principle is it envelops fact around everything. But see, humankind think fact is limited to physical properties. And I'm suggesting to you that's not true. Fact is limited to spiritual properties, emotional properties, physical properties. Facts are even about facts about how love is transmitted. There are mathematical facts about how love flows. That's why many of you can't receive love, because you're not engaging the mathematical fact about how it flows. Right? We can talk about the from an emotion, but we could also talk about it mathematically if you wanted to, but I don't know if you'd be very interested in it, because the problem is that most people are not interested in the mathematics of anything, let alone emotion. Right? But it is truth enforces and compels through the law, is enforced and compelled. All creation lives within the framework of mathematical, scientific, spiritual and emotional fact. Interesting concept. True concept too. How everything that is alive, everything that exists lives within a framework of fact. You know, and remember we said last night, this is how you use a mobile phone. If metals didn't live within a framework of fact, and if elements didn't live within a framework of fact, and creative processes didn't live within a framework of fact, in other words, repeatable, definable, permanent fact, then it would be impossible for anybody to have ever created a mobile phone. Just a simple device, and we nowadays believe it's not that simple device, right? But it's all based upon fact. All based upon fact. Without the fact of those laws existing and the properties of those individual materials existing, then the device could never have been created. So, very important to understand how important truth is to your life. Precision and certainty in the framework and fabric of creation. This is the beauty of it, is it's repeatable. Truth ensures everything is repeatable, permanent. It allows you to do something with a device today and then come along tomorrow and have the same function for that device. If this law, these principles didn't exist, you'd pick up a mobile phone today and it would dispense some coffee, and you pick up a mobile phone tomorrow and it would start talking to you, and you pick up a mobile phone the next day and all of a sudden you've got a video. Oh, that can be done. But you pick up a mobile phone the next day and all of a sudden it's berating you by itself. And, you know, all these different things would be happening, right? Because everything would be totally unpredictable. It would be just whatever the mobile phone decided would come up without any, if it could so decide, or whatever the principles governing these particular laws on the day happened to be. Now, fortunately, God never created God's universe like that, because everything would be so unpredictable that you'd be totally frightened every single moment of your existence, if you could exist for any length of time. Right? Fact makes life possible. Fact also makes love possible. This is why truth and love have to be joined together. Without the two, life is not possible, and emotions of enjoyment, happiness, and those kind of emotions are also not possible. So very important to understand that. So let's have a look at that, how that looks in terms of some examples with gravity. Isn't it wonderful? I can measure it. Right? So here is we, Earth. It's a mass. There is a law that determines that the larger the mass, the larger the gravitational pull on other masses. Right? And so that allows us then to eventually even get to the stage where we can calculate what the force is. And on the Earth, given its size and its mass, at the circumference, it's 9.78 meters per second squared. It's an accelerating force that's imposed by the mass upon everything that sits on that mass, or every other mass that is attracted to that mass. Even the sun has an interaction with the Earth's gravitation. The Earth's gravity field, of course. So here we go. Oh, by the way, at the pole, it's 9.83 meters per second squared. Interesting fact. Why do you think that might be? Because it's spinning. And it's spinning faster here than it is there, so there's more force pulling you off of the Earth at this point than there is here. So you go down to into the equator, and you might fly off. No, it's not like that at all, because we've got 9.78 meters per second still. So the average of that works out to be 9.8 meters per second squared, which is what they use to calculate gravitational pull on objects. So isn't it wonderful? You can describe it. It's permanent. Given the size of the mass, the weight of that mass, what the mass is, it's permanent pull. Which means that we can say, right, let's plan to go to the moon. The moon's this size, So given the fact that it has potentially this mass based upon the calculation of the the sphere and what it might contain, then we would be able to calculate the potential of that gravitational pull from that. Can you see? So now I can create devices that don't have to worry about such a heavy pull on Earth that I can utilize to move around on the moon. That obviously they're going to have less stresses on their wheel systems and so forth because there's less, you can pile them up with more rocks or whatever it is than you would be able to here because there's less pressure on the tires and so forth as a result of the lowered gravity. So this enables me to travel even to other places in space and predict what the gravitational pull may be. So do you want to travel to Jupiter? It's a bad idea for the human body because the gravitational pull is so strong that you'd be squashed into a little ball. Right? So it's not a good idea to visit Jupiter. You might visit one of its moons, but you certainly wouldn't want to go to the planet itself without there being some kind of way of counteracting this gravitational pull. So you can even predict what might be dangerous as a result, just because of the fact. Right? And that's how scientists predicted with a certain degree of fact of how to actually circumnavigate the globe with satellites and circumnavigate the globe with a manned space station. Right? They wouldn't do it if it wasn't predictable, right? You imagine signing up for the job? You might die tomorrow, you might die in a week's time, you might never get there, but do you want to go? I don't think there'd be too many people going, yeah, take me. Except those who are probably wishing for suicide to be their actual result, right? So this is an example of, you know, the law of truth being imposed upon, this principle of truth being imposed upon law. The same applies, of course, to aerodynamics, the potential of flight. The law defines the primary conditions for flight. So what are the primary conditions for flight? Do you know what they are? There's four things. Yeah? Do you want to yell them out if you think you know them?
Pressure, speed.
Well, speed. What's speed really, though? It's like velocity, momentum. What would you classify it as? Do you want me to write them all down for you?
Yes.
Okay, let's do it. Okay. I'll just get my notes here. Yeah. So there's four. Yeah, so they are the four things that are involved in flight. You know, something that creates lift, something that you need thrust to create lift of a certain thing. Drag is the pull of the air that you're going through. Air is like fluid, and therefore it has a pull upon the object you're trying to push through it. And then you've got the weight of the actual object, so that defines how, you know, much wingspan or how much wing, what the wing curvature and so forth needs to be to create the necessary lift to fly. And then, of course, while you're flying, there's three controls. There's roll, there's pitch, and what's the third one? Yaw. So you've got roll is like the plane. If you're looking at the plane, roll is like that movement, right? Pitch is, if you're looking at the plane where on the wing, this is going back and down and up, right? And yaw is when it's going like this, from side to side, and they're all able to be controlled by surfaces on the plane. And so now that gives us some predictability, given the aerodynamic properties of air at different latitudes, at different heights from the Earth, gives us some predictability of what we're going to be able to manage. And this is why some planes can only go a certain height, because they run out of lift at that height to actually go further and so forth. But they're all predictable requirements, right, for flight. Now, if we couldn't measure them and we couldn't predict them and they weren't constant, where would we be? Again, you go, let's go for a mystery flight. You might come back, or you might fly out into outer space if there's no gravity, or you might hit the ground at a few thousand kilometres an hour, or would you like to pay me for that flight? I don't think so, right? If there was no predictability, of course you wouldn't. Your life would be threatened. Beauty of truth is it gives me this predictability in all law. It is the fundamental fact of the laws. It's fantastic that God's done that. These are just basic things we think about, but at the end of the day, it's remarkable, really, when you think about it, how much design there is in it. Let's look at the physical properties of substances and elements. So all matter has individual characteristics and properties, right? And each element of the same kind exhibits the same properties under the same circumstances. That's a great thing, you know. This is a great thing. Imagine one day you build a house and the next day you can walk straight through it. That's what it would be like if it was all unpredictable. Each substance had unpredictability. That's what would happen. Everything would not be able to be predicted in terms of what you could do with it. Right. So this basic property of substances gives us things like when you put two atoms of hydrogen together with one atom of oxygen together, what do you get? You get an element H2O, and that you can actually drink. Right, but there are mathematical properties in the oxygen and the hydrogen that allow it to combine and form a mixed element. So two gases forming a fluid on the planet. Of course, that fluid can become a gas if it's heated. Right, but it has natural properties that even sustain our own life. Now imagine if that didn't exist. Our body is 70% water, and each day the two hydrogens decided, no, I'm not going to mix with the oxygen today. Where would your body be? You'd just fly apart, right? Your entire existence would not even be possible physically. Yeah, Natalie, you would like to ask?
You're just talking about predictability and how in some of the laws God's trying to generate an emotion inside of us. It feels like when you're saying about this predictability that God's trying to generate, well, for me, I'm gaining a feeling of trust in the laws.
Exactly.
And in God.
Exactly. Trust is an emotion, is it not?
Yeah.
Yep. And this is what God wants you to do, is to trust what he's done. And he's taught you trust. In fact, there's so many things you trust in the course of a day, which are all dependent upon law, all dependent on variable factors that, you know, if you really knew what was going on, most of us would just go, you know, considering the level of fear most of us have, we'd be freaked to go out anywhere. But we'd also be too freaked to stay home because of all the, you know, animals and creatures and particles and elements that are all governed by law there as well. So in the end, you'd be too frightened to do anything. So the reality is, We have a level of fear, but most of the level of fear is, of course, based upon ignorance, not based upon truth. Because if it was based upon truth, we'd probably have none, right? Mm-hmm. And this is why truth is the antidote to fear.
And before I met you, I had no concept of gravity, took it completely for granted,
yeah.
Had no gratitude for it.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden I'm like marvelling at something that's been
amazing group. It's a group of laws, actually. A group of substances, a group of laws, all combining to create one, what we call the law of gravity, which is actually a great combination of millions of different different elements that form gravity, but we call it the law of gravity, and it's just a remarkable thing. But it's a very basic thing too, isn't it? Like, you know, very basic law that we've got some rudimentary, most of us have rudimentary understanding of. Okay. So each substance has this, of the same kind exhibits the same truth. Isn't it wonderful? Yep. Imagine picking up water today, having a nice drink, picking up water tomorrow and it's poisonous. You keel over and you're dead. What a terrible thing. It'd be so unpredictable. You'd be too afraid to do anything, wouldn't you? Like I just think about you'd be going around hypersensitive. What's going to do today? What's it going to do today? What's it going to do? And this is how we feel with people a lot of times, but that's another subject. So the law of attraction, lovely law again, exposes me to the truth of my own condition by attracting circumstances and situations that expose the truth about my condition. So that's great. So I can measure my condition by what I attract, and I can actually respond to that and work my way through that and deal with that emotionally. Once I know my condition, I can see the causes of what I'm attracting. So a so-called accident happens, I can see what inside of me may have caused that, decision-wise or desire-wise or condition-wise. Wonderful law. Without truth, that law wouldn't exist. Couldn't exist, actually. Yeah. Oh, pretty remarkable, isn't it? When you think about it? Yeah. Okay. We can go on for more and more. Physical illness in the human body. If I'm ill, the truth principle, law of compensation, law of cause and effect, law of attraction work together to tell me what I'm denying about love of self or love of others or love of my environment that's caused this particular problem or illness. So that means every single illness is predictable. Every single disease is predictable. We just don't believe it is. So, because we don't understand the laws involved, right? So, isn't it wonderful? The truth principles are really impossible for humans to understand again without receiving God's love, but they ensure consistency, existence, harmony, and predictability in creation. Without them, nothing could exist, actually. So the beauty of God's principles is they sustain existence. So they're sort of the opposite of human law. Human law gets in your way, right? That's what most of us think anyway. But God's law is actually there to sustain your existence. Without it, there'll be no existence. So it ensures fearlessness, security and safety for all creation. We have the predictability, therefore we have the ability to go and make choices and decisions yesterday and today and tomorrow that are identical, expecting these same results. So that's all possible through truth principles. And unfortunately, again, they are the principles that we most frequently oppose, and to be frank with you, the majority of you are still opposing. The majority of you still do not tell the truth. You're not open and transparent about the truth. You are presenting a facade to the world. So in that regard, you're opposing the truth principle. And you're doing it because of fear. Fear is the reason why you're doing it. And yet it's one of the most essential principles to get. And to be frank with you, unless you learn to live your harmony and life in harmony with truth principle, it's highly unlikely you're going to understand at the soul level, hardly anything else. That's how important it is. So that's something we need to change emotionally. Yeah. Okay, well, our next session, which is now, we could just have a minute as changeover. Myself and Lena have got some things to do to change over. And we'll do some Q&A on those two subjects, all right? If you'd just be patient with us for a second or two or a minute. While we're doing the changeover, that'd be great. Thanks, guys. All right, so we're now discussing love and truth principles Q&A. The first section we're going to look at is the love principle. So for the first, we've got about 12 minutes for each one at this stage, and we'll talk about that. And there's a number of good questions here, which I'll cover first. So basically what we're looking at, things, questions about what the love principles are, why they're applied and so forth. So with Louise, if we start with your question first, nice simple question, thank you.
Why does God feel love is more important than all of the other things, or why are love and truth the highest principles? Is that the question you mean?
Well, no, the question you asked that I had written down here was why is love more important than all the other principles?
Yeah.
And the answer is quite simple. In that, firstly, love isn't, you need to remain standing so the guys can, sorry, as I know it's a bit hard. The answer is that love isn't the most important of all other principles. love and truth together are the most important of all other principles. So firstly, we need to see that it's love and truth together, because actually truth provides a framework for love to exist, just like love provides a framework for truth to exist. They can't be removed from each other. So the two principles have to exist together, and they are the highest of God's principles. And the simple answer to that is, well, there's a complicated answer, and that is about, you know, why truth is so essential to love and why love is so essential to truth. But can I just simplify it for you? Because God made it that way.
Okay.
Does that make sense? Now, that might sound like a silly answer, but if you drill down into it a bit, basically it tells you a lot about God, eh? Tells you that God wants everything to be predictable, God wants everything to be factual, God wants everything to be honest, everything to be sincere. It tells me, it reveals so much about God wants you to be happy, wants you to have emotions of feeling like you're loved and cared for and secure and safe. All of those things are all a part of the reasons why God did it. But to me, it's like, well, God did it, and that is the highest. And so at some point, we just need to accept that. But there are a whole heap of emotional reasons why God's made it that way for love and truth to be the pinnacle of those principles. And they're all based upon like this beautiful, compassionate and expressive personality and nature that God has, that where God wants your joy and wants your happiness and wants your to care for you and wants to be compassionate for you. And God wants so many things for you that... Look, the reality is God wants so many things for us that we have not even no idea about yet. You know, that will bring us joy. And that demonstrates that God's motivation is pure and like just ultimately pure and loving with every single thing that God has created. These two principles to me mean that everything God has done has been for your benefit. Everything. Yeah, remarkable really, isn't it? That the infinite being in the universe, the only one, wants your happiness and joy. Amazing, really.
Wow.
When you start to feel God's nature a bit, you go, "Why? What am I doing not having a relationship with him?" It's like, well, how crazy is that? Because all of these things demonstrate the reality of God's desire for your and concern for your welfare and happiness. Yeah. So that's why God made it that way.
Thank you.
Dinah, where were you? Yep. If you want to say your question.
I think this was the one I'd written down.
Yep.
Are you saying that it's through the expression of God's will, governed by God's attributes, etc., that love principles are naturally enforced and compelled by the compensatory actions of God's laws?
Yes, it's not just the compensatory actions of God's laws, though, as you'll find out. Love is imbued in every one of God's principles and every one of God's laws, not just the laws that revolve around compensatory issues. However, if you examine compensatory issues, the principle of compensation is if you do something that's in harmony with love, you will be rewarded. And if you do something without out of harmony with love, you will be penalized. That is enforcing love, isn't it? Right? So the compensatory issues certainly do. But there are so many other laws and principles that also demonstrate the principle. So the law of attraction, law of cause and effect, and all those kind of laws all demonstrate the principle. Even the law of desire, the fact that God rewards you having a pure desire, is in fact another expression of the love and truth principles. If your desire is pure, that's the truth principle at work, and in harmony with love, there's the love principle at work. Now you can attract to yourself a whole heap of circumstances and situations that you wouldn't be able to attract to yourself before. So this is your soul designed in such a way that a desire is expressed. It happens to be harmonious with love and harmonious with truth. And now there's rewards, only rewards for that. No negatives, no penalties, nothing. Just only rewards. And so this... you know, it's not right to say that it's just the compensatory-based laws that demonstrate God's love and truth principles, and particularly God's love principle, because every single law does. Even the fact that God created something that allows you to transform your soul, if you engage it, is based around love. Like something, God didn't have to do that, but he did. He enabled your soul to grow. You know, if you look at most humans, what do they do when they know something? They hold on to the knowledge, don't they? They don't share it, and they don't have it. If they have joy themselves, they're very competitive. They don't really want other people to have the same joys, right? And as a result of that, we often experience this selfish taking all the time. Well, God's not like that. God's got all these infinite qualities, and God's going, I want to share them all with you for your own enjoyment. No other reason. No other reason. No motivation. No forcing. No control. I just want to share them with you because you'll love them. Right? There's the love principle at work again. So it's actually in every principle, not just in the compensatory principles and laws. Yep.
I guess what I don't understand then, yep, is how the combination of laws that work together, like the law of desire, then and working together with the law of compensation, or
yep,
yeah.
Yeah, and it's important to come to understand that. And this is why it's important when we get to the soul-specific principles in the last 2 days, and also the order-based principles, which are very much soul-driven. It's very important to come to understand how they all interplay with each other and how your desire and your will have a large effect on what happens around you, which we've been trying to teach for 8 years, isn't it?
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, so you know, it's just a matter of understanding why that's all happening. And this, hopefully this group will help you understand why.
Yep. Yeah, thank you.
Yep. Nat, can we go to Nat?
This is about the human soul.
This is about love, and it's about the human soul, yes?
Is only the human soul able to experience God's personal love?
Yes.
Thanks.
That's all I have to say. Why? Why do you reckon? Because only the human soul is a self-aware being, and to experience God's love on a personal level, you need to be self-aware. So, yes. So all other creatures experience God's love, but they are not aware of that experience. Does that make sense? So it's there present for them, but they are not aware of the experience. It's only the human soul that has the capacity of awareness. So it's only the human soul that's able to receive the personal love feeling from God and actually be aware that they're receiving it and even develop a desire to receive it, because desire, again, is connected to a self-aware being. Other beings do not have desire, they have instinct, which is different to desire. Yep. Next, can we go to just time? Yep. If we go to Deidre, where are you, Deidre, again? Down here. So if we... And where's Dave? Where are you, Dave? Oh, you're up the back. Yep. Just... Yep. Far away, Deidre.
With the objectives to ensure all creation experiences the expression of God's love, does this then mean that if mankind destroys one of God's creations on earth, like the Tasmanian tiger,
yeah,
how
do they then experience the expression, yeah, of God's love?
Yeah.
Well, you see, this is where we often get a bit confused, is it not? Why did the Tasmanian tiger become extinct?
I believe that we killed it.
Ah, yes, humans did not love it. That's why it became extinct. Why did bison in the US become extinct? Why did, you know, all these different things, dodo bird, there's parrots in Australia that become extinct. Why are they become extinct? Because we did not love them. That's why they become extinct. This is demonstrating only the effect of the humans living out of harmony with love. It's not demonstrating whether God's love is flowing to that creation still. And in fact, the fact that many of these creations, in fact, the majority of them, all of those with a central nervous system, survive their physical death and also have a spirit-based existence means that God has already imbued love in their experience. He created them with the ability to die from humans' destruction of the whole species, but still exist in another location, just in a different form, right? Which is an expression of God's love. So God would prefer that humans didn't cause all of our, you know, many of these animals to go extinct, but it is an expression of the human's lack of love, not God's lack of love, that it happens. And humans, being free will beings, have been given this power of governance over the rest of creation, which we will discuss as one of the principles. Does that make sense? Yep. If we go to Dave up the back.
When you say love is enforced, compelled and upheld, and also the law enforces and compels love, how is this done? I only have a view of how human law enforces and is punitive.
Yeah, it's a good question, Dave. This is the trouble with the discussion of a lot of these things that we're trying to discuss with you, is that when we use the word compel or enforce, your viewpoint of compulsion or enforcement is very violent, is it not? And naturally so, because that's been our experience on the planet. When humans force or compel something, they usually use violence, whether that was a parent who belted us when we were a child, or used some other mechanism to enforce something, or a government, or you know, or a country. We all experience those particular things. So what we then do, and this is a part of our human law hangover, which we will be discussing, we then start thinking about that word as it implies in this particular situation with God's laws. And the reality is God's laws do compel action. So all of God's laws compel you to become more loving. And the way they do that is very loving, in that they provide loving corrective assistance to you when you're out of harmony with love. So it's not violent corrective assistance, it's loving corrective assistance. So you could call it God's corrective action, is not punitive only. It's not there to just punish you for something you've done wrong, right? And also God's laws measure your attitude and emotion about that thing. So for example, if you did it purposefully, there is a different response by the law than if you did it mistakenly. Can you see? Now, most humans don't treat it that way. Mistake or purposeful, usually they get the same penalty generally. And nowadays there's more laws that allow for some level of mistaken or accidental thing. But even so, we're still pretty punitive even with that, right? But God's laws measure that inside of you. They measure the level of ignorance. They even measure whether you wanted to be ignorant and then did it, or whether you wanted to know and you mistakenly did it. Do you see? They even measure that. So the beauty of God's laws is they're very refined, and they allow you then the response of the law based on the love principle is that it allows you, it measures your will and your desire as a part of the compensatory effects of correcting your behaviour, which is a very powerful thing to help you realise that you're being loved while you're being corrected. Yeah. But humans, what do we do when we try to correct? When we try to correct, generally it's only punitive, isn't it?
And can I add, and when humans do that, it's not it's a coercion rather than a cooperation.
Often manipulative, and yeah, often based upon the person who's manipulating you own desire, which is also unloving. So it's often not motivated by a pure love for everything. It's motivated generally by the person's personal desire to just get away with something themselves. So this is our problem as humans. We then think that God has the same kind of motivations, which God obviously does not have. Mm.
Yeah, thank you.
Good question, Dave. Let's move on now to the truth Q&A. So it would be truth principles Q&A now, because we're running out of time, so we need to just focus on discussing some things about the truth Q&A. So we'll go to there, and I'll get out my truth list that people have got here. There's a few questions here that are good. So let's start. Whoops, I've mixed them up. Just let me sort that out. Okay, Jane. Where's Jane? Down the front here. Can we have the mic down with Jane? You've asked a couple of questions, Jane. Let's answer both of them. Fire away with the first one.
Is truth a substance we receive from God into our soul like love?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. You have the capacity to receive God's truth as a substance, just like you have the capacity to receive God's love. However, there are laws that govern its reception. And as you can imagine, one of those laws has to be surrounding truth itself. So it has to be about your desire for it. And what I notice in most people is they have very little desire for truth, particularly when it comes to personal truth, particularly when it comes to emotional and spiritual truth. So the majority of mankind are fairly open to physical truths, right? But when it comes to spiritual truths, like truths about love, and emotional truths, very closed. Most of humankind are very closed. Now that, of course, means that we're very close to receiving any truth from God as a substance. So we're blocked to it. And as a result of being blocked to it, we can't receive it. It's quite simple. We're using our will to prevent its reception. But it is a substance we can receive, and this is why when you receive God's love, you automatically are also receiving truths as well. And this is why many people try to shut it down, because oftentimes when God's giving you some love, he's also giving you truth at the same time. Because remember, the two are not separated from each other, the two principles are not able to be separated. So for example, you may enter a state of repentance for behavior about, you know, how you've acted towards your children or something like that. God, then you ask for God's forgiveness and God gives you some love. But in that process of giving you some love, he exposes to you that it's a lot bigger than what you thought it was, the damage that you did. And then you have to cope with that emotionally. And now most people find that they don't cope with that emotionally. They can't, or they say they can't, but God designed you to. But they say they can't. They shut that down. So therefore, they don't receive love or truth after that point. Can you see? So it is a problem that we face. This it's very interesting with the issue of truth. It's of all the questions you guys have asked, this is the one that you've had the least amount of questions about, which is interesting in itself. It tells me that it's the thing that least interests you. Right? So what interests you the most is external truths. What interests you the least is what is the emotional and spiritual truth associated with you as an individual. That's where we're blocked. That's where we're having our biggest strife in receiving God's love. That's the area we need to do some work on. And then we'll be open to receiving truth along with the love. So you see, the truth will come along with the love. So, you know, most of you are like this. Give me some love. Don't give me any truth at the same time. Do you see? But the two principles from God's perspective are joined. So when you say don't give me truth, but give me love, what are you really saying? Don't give me anything. That's really what you're saying. Right? We need to understand that the desire for truth is just as important. And if there's a desire for love. And this is why I said in the first century, keep on then seeking first the truth and love. You know, both things you need to seek. And the person who seeks truth always finds it. Why is that? Because God wants to give it. And if you're really seeking it, you'll always find it. Right? So, yeah, very important to understand that truth is a part of the reception of God's love, and that God's love will expose truths that you never were previously aware of, and particularly truths about yourself that you don't want to feel. And if you don't want to feel them, you will shut it down and therefore shut down the flow of love. Right? And remember, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. In other words, the Holy Spirit, which is a conduit, it's a conduit between you and God, it's actually driven by desire. So it's a physical thing that has to happen inside of your soul, of desire, has to be generated, that establishes this conduit that is always open from God's perspective to your soul. This conduit, the Holy Spirit, which allows the flow of love, cannot connect with you without you being in a state or of desiring truth. That's why the two are also joined together. That makes sense? So this truth issue is a very big issue. And for the majority of us, if you examine how you are applying the truth principle in your day-to-day life, the majority of you will see that you're still very much in a facade, still very much wanting addictions met, you're not being sincere, still very much wanting to avoid truth where possible, to avoid the truth of every interaction, and feed untruth in others as well as yourself. And this is an indication that you've still got many blocks towards receiving God's love, because remember, God's love and truth are joined. You can't deny one and hope to receive the other. Right? And this is why for most people who have heard about divine love being available to them as a person, most people have hit and miss affair when it comes to receiving love. And this is the reason why. Because we're rejecting truth while we're trying to receive love. And that's not possible from God's perspective. He wants to give you the truth along with the love. And in fact, he's designed a whole heap of laws that state, I'm only going to give you truth, love along with the truth. I'm only going to do it. And in fact, you have to be even in a state of truth of truly desiring it sincerely inside of yourself before I'll even give it. And that's all related. Does that make sense? Yeah. And your second question?
What do you mean by the objective of God's truth is to provide a fixed framework for the operation of love?
Yeah, so I think now my previous answer to you has really provided the answer to that question, hasn't it? You can see that without truth existing, love's not really possible. And without love existing, truth is not really possible. The two need each other. And so truth provides the framework for which love can flow through to you. Truth is the thing that does that. And love provides a framework for the truth to exist. So the two are hand in hand with each other, and without understanding that, we're going to keep, and this is what I notice many in the audience and many that are listening and still doing, they keep wanting to be loved while at the same time not wanting to know the truth. Right? And the reality is it's impossible for anyone to love you unless they are truthful with you. Impossible. And it's impossible for you to love somebody else unless you're truthful with them. It's also an impossibility. And if we understand that relationship, we'd be a lot hotter on developing our desire for truth, wouldn't we? Instead of trying to oppose it and prevent it and fight it all the time and argue about it, you know, many of you, as soon as we mention a little bit of truth to you, argue, you know, you wouldn't do that. If you really understood the importance of truth in your life, you just wouldn't do that. You'd be open to analysing each truth that hits you, whether it be through the law of attraction or through somebody's expression or through what God's trying to tell you when he gives you some love. Whatever the reason is, you'd be open. You'd be open to dealing with it. Yeah. Okay, well, guys, I'm now a minute over our break time, so I think it's better if we stop there, because otherwise all the whole day gets out of whack. But thank you for your questions there. I feel, again, questions are pretty good questions. And so what we're doing is now having a half-hour break. If we come back at 1 o'clock, it's 2 o'clock, and we'll get started on life and development principles.